Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Facilitating with Ease, Core Skills for Facilitators, Team Leaders and Members, Managers, Consultants, and Trainers, 4th Edition, by Ingrid Bens, narrated by Kim Niemi. Publisher's Note: This audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type Facilitating with Ease into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page. Then, under the supplemental content section, please enter the access code TRUST and then click the Unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. All checklists, assessments, tables, charts, structured conversations, grids, and diagrams referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Introduction. It's impossible to be part of an organization today and not attend meetings. Staff meetings, project meetings, task force meetings, planning and coordinating meetings, the list is endless. The worst thing about many of these meetings is that they're poorly run and waste valuable time. Today, there's a growing recognition that effective meetings happen when proper attention is paid to the process elements and when proceedings are skillfully facilitated. For a long time, facilitation has been a rather vague and poorly understood practice, mastered only by human resource types. This is beginning to change. We're now spending so much time in meetings and being asked to achieve so many important goals in teams that there's a growing need for skilled facilitation throughout our organizations and our communities. Instead of being relegated to HR, facilitation is fast becoming a core competency for anyone who leads a team, manages a project, heads up a committee, or manages a department. All of these people need to be able to create and manage effective group dynamics that foster true collaboration. Facilitation is also a central skill for today's managers who are riding wave after wave of change. New demands are being placed on them. At the same time, the old command and control model of supervision, which worked for decades, is no longer as effective. To get the most from people today, leaders have to know how to create buy-in, generate participation, and empower people. To keep pace, today's leaders need to be coaches, mentors, and teachers. At the core of each of these new roles is the skill of facilitation. The goal of this book. This practical workbook has been created to make core facilitation tools and techniques readily available to the growing number of people who want to improve their process skills. It represents materials and ideas that have been collected, tested, and refined over decades of active facilitation in all types of settings. This 4th edition retains the core tools and instruments that made the first 3 editions so popular. In addition, new materials have been added to every chapter. As in the previous 3 editions, Facilitating with Ease remains a practical workbook. While it builds on the theories of organization development pioneers such as Chris Argyris, Donald Shun, and Edgar Schein, this resource doesn't aim to be theoretical. Instead, its focus is on providing the listener with the most commonly used process tools in a simple and accessible format. This is not so much a book to be heard as one to be used. With its focus on asking instead of telling, listening, and building consensus, facilitation is the essential skill for anyone working collaboratively with others. The audience. This workbook contains valuable information for anyone facilitating group interactions. This is a huge constituency, which includes team leaders and team members, project managers, any supervisor or manager who holds staff meetings, community developers, teachers in traditional classroom settings, therapists who lead support groups, marketing consultants who run focus groups, teachers of adult continuing education programs, negotiators and conflict mediators, quality consultants leading process improvement initiatives like Six Sigma, consultants intervening in conflicts, anyone teaching others to facilitate, anyone called on to lead a discussion or run a meeting. Since facilitation was designed as a role for neutral outsiders, the strategies and techniques in this book are described from the perspective of the external facilitator. Since more and more facilitation is being done by those who have a stake in the outcome of discussions, the third edition includes strategies that help leaders and group members manage the challenges of staying neutral. Content overview. The book is organized into 11 chapters. Checklists and tools have not been collected in an appendix, but instead are located throughout each chapter near the related materials. Chapter 1 outlines what facilitation is and its main applications. It differentiates process from content and outlines the core practices. It also addresses facilitation issues such as neutrality, how assertive a facilitator can be, and how to balance the role of the group leader with that of the facilitator. Chapter 1 also describes what facilitators do at the beginning, middle, and end of discussions. It provides information about the language of facilitation, the principles of giving and receiving feedback, plus a thumbnail sketch of the best and worst practices of facilitators. At the end of the chapter, there are two observation sheets and a four-level skills self-assessment useful to anyone hoping for feedback on current skills. Chapter 2 is a new addition to this book. It features important information about the central role of questioning in the practice of facilitation and how to use questions effectively. Question types and formats are outlined, along with guidance about the importance of follow-on questions. This new chapter also provides a bank of questions that are useful for learning more about the client. Chapter 3 explores the stages of designing and managing a facilitation assignment. It describes the importance of each step in the facilitation process: assessment, design, feedback, refinement, and final preparation. Helpful checklists are also provided to guide the start, middle, and end of any facilitation session. Chapter 4 focuses on how facilitation can be managed by leaders. This is a major new addition and reflects the growing awareness among leaders of the importance of process management. This chapter explores the challenges leaders face when they facilitate and provides strategies that help leaders effectively manage a group process. This chapter also discusses the issues encountered when the facilitator feels he or she lacks authority or is working with people of senior rank. Chapter 5 focuses on knowing your participants and provides information about the four most commonly used needs assessment techniques. Sample assessment questions and surveys are provided. This chapter also discusses the differences between facilitating groups and facilitating teams and passes along strategies for getting any group to behave more like an effective team. The creation of team norms is discussed, along with an overview of the team growth stages and the corresponding facilitation strategies that work best at each stage. Chapter 6 begins with a frank discussion of the many reasons people are often less than enthusiastic to be involved in a meeting or workshop and provides tested strategies for overcoming these blocks, including ideas on gaining buy-in. High participation techniques are also shared, along with a training plan to encourage effective meeting behaviors in members. Chapter 7 delves into the complexities of decision-making. Facilitators are introduced to the types of discussions and the importance of clarifying empowerment. Various methods for reaching decisions are described and differentiated. The pros, cons, and uses of each approach are explored, along with an expanded discussion of consensus building. Chapter 7 also offers an overview of the behaviors that help decision effectiveness and provides the steps in the systematic consensus building process. The chapter ends with a discussion of poor decisions, their symptoms, causes, and cures. A survey is provided with which a group can assess its current decision-making effectiveness. Chapter 8 deals with facilitative strategies for handling both conflict and resistance. It begins with an overview of the difference between healthy debates and dysfunctional arguments. It goes on to share techniques that encourage healthy debates and the steps in managing any conflict. Special attention is paid to strategies for venting emotions. The five conflict management options are also explored and placed into the context of which are most appropriate for facilitators. Chapter 8 also provides a three-part format for wording interventions that tactfully allows a facilitator to redirect inappropriate behavior. Also described are the two approaches a facilitator can choose when confronted with resistance and why one is superior. At the end of the chapter, 9 common facilitator dilemmas and their solutions are presented. Chapter 9 focuses on meeting management. There's a useful checklist and meeting effectiveness diagnostic that lets groups assess whether or not their meetings are working. There's also a chart that outlines the symptoms and cures for common meeting ills. The fundamentals of meeting management are outlined, with special emphasis on the role of the facilitator as compared to the traditional chairperson role. Both midpoint checks and exit surveys are explained, and samples are provided. Since virtual meetings are on the rise, strategies are offered for using facilitation techniques during distance meetings. Chapter 10 contains the process tools that are fundamental to all facilitation activities. These include visioning, sequential questioning, force field analysis, brainstorming, gap analysis, root cause analysis, decision grids, affinity diagrams, needs and offers dialogue, systematic problem solving, survey feedback, multi-voting, and troubleshooting. Each tool is described, and step-by-step directions are given for using it. Chapter 11 pulls it all together by providing 17 sets of process design notes, complete with detailed step-by-step instructions. In this fourth edition, the meeting design notes have been updated to include the virtual version of each conversation. These notes will be a real asset to facilitators who conduct meetings with far-flung groups. The 17 structured conversations in this chapter represent the discussions facilitators are most often called upon to lead. These examples provide a graphic illustration of the level of detail a facilitator needs to develop before stepping in front of any group. After years of experience as a consultant, project manager, team leader, and trainer, I'm convinced that it's impossible to build teams, consistently achieve consensus, or run effective decision-making meetings without highly developed facilitation skills. The good news is that these skills can be mastered by anyone. I hope you find the fourth edition of Facilitating with Ease to be a valuable resource in your quest to gain this important skill. September 2017, Ingrid Bens, M.Ed., CPF. Questions answered in this book. What is facilitation? When do I use it? What's the role of the facilitator? What are the main tools and techniques? What are the values and attitudes of a facilitator? How neutral do I really need to be? How assertive am I allowed to be? How can those who have a stake in the group's decisions facilitate? How can I facilitate when I'm not the official facilitator? How do I balance the roles of chairperson and facilitator? How do I get everyone to participate? Can facilitation techniques be used to manage distance meetings? How do I overcome people's reluctance to open up? What's the difference between a group and a team? How can I get a group to act like a team? What do I do if a group is very cynical? What do I do if I encounter high resistance? What if there's zero buy-in? What are my options for dealing with conflict? What if a meeting falls apart and I lose control? What decision-making techniques are available? Why is consensus building most effective for arriving at a group decision? What can go wrong in making decisions? How do I make sure that discussions achieve closure? What facilitation tools are available? How do I design an effective process? How do I know whether the meeting is going well? What are the elements of an effective meeting design? How can facilitation be used to manage virtual meetings? Some definitions. Facilitator, one who contributes structure and process to interactions so groups are able to function effectively and make high-quality decisions. A helper and enabler whose goal is to support others as they pursue their objectives. Content, the topics or subjects under discussion at any meeting. Also referred to as the task, the decisions made, or the issues explored. Process, the structure, framework, methods, and tools used in interactions. Also refers to the climate or spirit established, as well as the style of the facilitator. Intervention, an action or set of actions that aims to improve the functioning of a group. Plenary, a large group session held to share the ideas developed in separate subgroups. Norms, a set of rules created by group members with which they mutually agree to govern themselves. Group, a collection of individuals who come together to share information, coordinate their efforts, or achieve a task, but who mainly pursue their own individual goals and work independently. Team, a collection of individuals who are committed to achieving a common goal, who support each other, who fully utilize member resources, and who have closely linked roles. Process agenda. A detailed step-by-step description of the tools and techniques used to bring structure to conversations. Project, a collaborative enterprise, frequently involving research or design, that is carefully planned to achieve a particular aim. Process improvement, a series of actions taken by a process owner to identify, analyze, and improve existing processes within an organization to meet new goals and objectives. Lean, a production practice that considers the expenditure of resources for any goal other than the creation of value for the end customer to be wasteful and thus a target for elimination. Basically, lean is centered on preserving value with less work. Six Sigma, a business management strategy that seeks to improve the quality of process outputs by identifying and removing the causes of defects or errors and minimizing variability. A Six Sigma process is one in which 99.99966% of the products manufactured are statistically expected to be free of defects, 3.4 defects per million. Chapter 1. Understanding Facilitation. If you look up the word facilitator in the dictionary, you'll see it described as someone who helps a group of people understand their common objectives and assists them to achieve these objectives without taking a particular position in the discussion. This role basically did not exist until the middle of the last century, when theorists in the emerging field of behavioral science identified the need for a leadership style that contributed structure to complex group interactions instead of directions and answers. The work of these behavioral pioneers led to the emergence of a new and important role in which the person who manages the meeting no longer participates in the discussion or tries to influence the outcome. Instead, he or she stays out of all conversations in order to focus on how the meeting is being run. Instead of offering opinions, this person provides participants with structure and tools. Instead of promoting a point of view, he or she manages participation to ensure that everyone is heard. Instead of making decisions and giving orders, he or she supports the participants in identifying their own goals and developing their own action plans. What is facilitation? Facilitation is a leadership role in which the decision-making power resides in the members. This frees the facilitator to focus on creating a climate of collaboration and provide the group with the structure it needs to be effective. Instead of offering solutions, facilitators offer group members tools they can use to develop their own answers. Facilitators attend meetings to guide members through their discussions step by step, encouraging them to reach their own conclusions. Rather than being a player, facilitators act more like referees. They watch the action more than participate in it. They help members define their goals. They ensure that group members have effective rules to guide interaction. They provide an orderly sequence of activities. They keep their fingers on the pulse and know when to move on or wrap things up. They keep discussion focused and help group members achieve closure. They do all of this while remaining neutral about the topics under discussion so as not to interfere with the decision-making authority of the group. What does a facilitator do? Facilitators make their contribution by conducting background research to understand the needs of the group and what they hope to achieve, helping the group define its overall goal as well as its specific objectives, preparing a detailed agenda that includes process notes describing how the interaction will unfold, helping the group create rules of conduct that create an effective climate, making sure that assumptions are surfaced and tested, questioning and probing to encourage deeper exploration, offering the right tools and techniques at the right moment, encouraging participation by everyone, guiding group discussion to keep it on track, making accurate notes that reflect the ideas of members, helping members constructively manage differences of opinion, redirecting ineffective behaviors, providing feedback to the group so that they can assess their progress and make adjustments, helping the group to achieve closure and identify next steps, helping the group access resources from inside and outside the group, providing a means for evaluation of the meeting and seeking improvements. Facilitators bring structure to interactions to make them productive. They plan carefully and then adapt as things unfold. For more on how facilitators organize and manage their work, refer to Chapter 3 on the stages of the facilitation process. What do facilitators believe? Facilitators operate by a core set of principles. At the heart of these is the belief that two heads are better than one, and that to do a good job, people need to be fully engaged and empowered. All facilitators firmly believe that people are intelligent, capable, and want to do the right thing. Groups can make better decisions than any one person can make alone. Everyone's opinion is of equal value, regardless of rank or position. People are more committed to the ideas and plans that they have helped to create. Participants can be trusted to assume accountability for their decisions. Groups can manage their own conflicts, behaviors, and relationships if they are given the right tools and training. The process, if well designed and honestly applied, can be trusted to achieve results. In contrast to the traditional model of leadership in which the leader is viewed as the most important person in the room, the facilitator puts the members first. Members decide the goals, make the decisions, implement action plans, and hold themselves accountable for achieving results. The facilitator's contribution is to provide structure and offer the right tools at the right time. Facilitating is ultimately about shifting responsibility from the leader to the members, from management to employees. By playing the process role, facilitators encourage group members to take charge. What are typical facilitator assignments? Neutral third-party facilitators are asked to design and lead a wide variety of meetings: strategic planning retreats, team-building events, sessions to clarify objectives and create detailed results indicators, priority-setting meetings, regular staff meetings, program review/evaluation sessions, communications/liaison meetings, meetings to negotiate team roles and responsibilities, problem-solving/process improvement sessions, meetings to share feedback and recommend improvements, focus groups for gathering input on a new program or product. Differentiating between process and content. The two words you'll hear over and over again in facilitation are process and content. These are the two dimensions of any interaction between people. The content of any meeting is what is being discussed, the task at hand, the subjects being dealt with, and the problems being solved. The content is expressed in the agenda and the words that are spoken. Because it's the verbal portion of the meeting, the content is obvious and typically consumes the attention of the members. Process deals with how things are being discussed, the methods, procedures, format, and tools used. The process also includes the style of the interaction, the group dynamics, and the climate that's established. Because the process is silent, it's harder to pinpoint. It's the aspect of most meetings that's largely unseen and often ignored while people are focused on the content. When the person leading the meeting offers an opinion with the intent of influencing the outcome of discussions, he or she is acting as the content leader. When a facilitator offers tools and focuses on managing member interaction, he or she is acting as the process leader. Content. What? The task. The subjects for discussion. The problems being solved. The decisions made. The agenda items. The goals. Process. How? The methods. How relations are maintained. The tools being used. The rules or norms set, the group dynamics, the climate. It is important to note that while facilitators are totally unassertive about the content under discussion, they are very assertive in the way they manage the process elements. This assertiveness is needed to deal with conflict, make interventions, and help the group when it gets stuck. At first glance, facilitation may seem like a rather vague set of warm and fuzzy, people-oriented stuff. But as you'll learn, it's actually a highly structured and assertive set of practices with a rich set of tools and techniques. Once you understand these techniques and learn how to apply them, you'll immediately see substantial improvement in the overall performance of any group. Facilitation tools. As a facilitator, you'll have an extensive set of tools at your disposal. These tools fall into two categories, the core practices and the process tools. The core practices, which are rooted in the manner, style, and behavior of the facilitator, include staying neutral, listening actively, asking questions, paraphrasing continuously, summarizing discussions, recording ideas, synthesizing ideas, keeping on track, testing assumptions, managing the climate. The process tools, which are structured activities that provide a clear sequence of steps, include visioning, force field analysis, brainstorming, priority setting, surveys, root cause analysis, gap analysis, decision grids, systematic problem solving. Understanding each of these tools and how to use them is a vital part of any facilitator's job. Core practices overview. Regardless of the type of meeting they're managing or the specific process tool being used, facilitators make constant use of the following core practices. Of these, the first five are foundational. These are in constant use during facilitation, regardless of what other tools are also deployed. 1. Facilitators stay neutral on the content. Staying neutral on the content of discussions is the hallmark of the facilitator role. Facilitators are neutral outsiders who have no stake in the outcome of discussions. They are there only to provide structure and create a climate of collaboration. When facilitators ask questions or make helpful suggestions, they never do this to impose their views or impact decisions. 2. They listen actively. This is listening to understand more than to judge. It also means using attentive body language and looking participants in the eye while they're speaking. Eye contact can also be used to acknowledge points and prompt quiet people to take part. 3. They ask questions. Questioning is the most fundamental facilitator tool. Questions can be used to test assumptions, probe for hidden information, challenge assumptions, and ratify for consensus. Effective questioning encourages people to look past symptoms to get at root causes. 4. They paraphrase continuously. Facilitators paraphrase continuously during discussions. Paraphrasing involves repeating what group members say. This lets people know they are heard and acknowledges their input. Paraphrasing also lets others hear points for a second time and provides an opportunity to clarify ideas. 5. They summarize discussions. Facilitators summarize ideas shared by members at the end of every discussion. They do this to ensure that everyone heard all of the ideas that were put forth, to check for accuracy, and to bring closure. Facilitators also summarize in the midst of discussions to catch everyone up on the conversation and refresh the topic during conversation lulls. Summarizing is also useful to restart a stalled discussion, since it reminds group members of the points already made and often sparks new thinking. In many decision-making discussions, consensus is created when the facilitator gives the group a clear and concise summarization of key points. In addition to the five techniques described before, there are several additional facilitator techniques that make up the core practices. Facilitators record ideas. Groups need to leave meetings with complete and accurate notes that summarize discussions. Facilitators quickly and accurately record what's being said. Whether they are using a flip chart or electronic whiteboard, they are careful to use the key words that people suggest and organize the notes into related groupings. There is more on recording group ideas later in this chapter. They synthesize ideas. Facilitators ping-pong ideas around the group to ensure that people build on each other's ideas. In non-decision-making conversations, they do this to build conversation and create synergy. In decision-making conversations, they ping-pong ideas to allow each person to add his or her comments to the points made by others until they have synthesized a statement everyone can live with. They keep discussions on track. When discussions veer off track or when people lose focus, facilitators notice this and tactfully point it out. They place a parking lot sheet on a wall and offer participants the option of placing extraneous topics on it for later discussion. They test assumptions. Facilitators outline the parameters, empowerment levels, and other constraints that apply so that they are understood by all. They are always on the lookout for situations in which misunderstandings are rooted in differing assumptions and probe carefully to uncover these. They manage the group climate. Facilitators help members set behavioral norms or group guidelines. Then they intervene tactfully when they notice that members are not adhering to their own rules. Refer to later chapters for more on both norms and making interventions. They make periodic process checks. This involves tactfully stopping the action whenever group effectiveness declines. Facilitators can intervene to check whether the purpose is still clear to everyone, the process is working, and the pace is effective, or to find out how people are feeling. They give and receive feedback. Facilitators always have their fingers on the pulse of the group and offer their perspective to help the group make adjustments. They are also receptive to input and invite members to point out anything that needs adjustment. At the end of each meeting, facilitators create mechanisms such as written evaluations or exit surveys to capture feedback for ongoing improvement. What does neutral mean? Facilitation was created to be a neutral role played by an unbiased outsider. The role of this neutral third party is solely to support group decision-making without exerting influence over the outcome. Facilitators, therefore, always focus on process and stay out of the content. One of the most difficult things about learning to facilitate is staying within the neutrality boundary because facilitators often have insight into the subject under discussion. The issue of neutrality is further complicated by the fact that a lot of facilitation isn't done by disinterested outsiders, but by someone from within the group who has a real stake in the outcome. This question of whether or not leaders can facilitate their own teams is so significant that an entire chapter of this book has been devoted to exploring this issue. For now, the discussion of neutrality will focus on the assumption that the facilitator is indeed a third-party outsider. It's important to note that staying neutral is a challenge, even for neutral outsiders. Sometimes group members say things that are obviously incorrect, or they miss important facts. In these instances, it's very difficult for the facilitator to hold back and maintain body language that hides a bias. Regardless of the situation, it's important to understand that neutrality can still be maintained by applying specific techniques. First strategy, ask questions. Even though the role is dispassionate, it's important to realize that facilitators don't want to enable bad decision-making. If the facilitator has an idea that might help the group, he or she should not withhold it. If the facilitator thinks that the group is overlooking an idea, the facilitator can introduce that idea as a question that sparks thought. For example, if the group is spinning its wheels because they can't afford new computers, the facilitator can ask, "What are the benefits of renting new computers as an interim strategy?" Through questioning, group members are being prompted to consider another option, but are not being told whether to accept or reject it. The facilitator's neutrality is maintained because he or she hasn't told the group what to do, and decision-making control remains with the members. Second strategy, offer suggestions. If the facilitator has a good content idea that the group should consider, it's within the bounds of the neutral role to offer the group a suggestion for their consideration. He or she might say, "I suggest that you consider researching the pros and cons of renting computers." Although this sounds like the facilitator has strayed into content, it's still facilitative if the content sounds like an offering, not an order. As with questioning, making suggestions doesn't violate neutrality as long as group members retain the power to decide. Third strategy, take off the facilitator's hat. If the group is about to make a serious mistake and all of the questioning and suggesting in the world has not worked to move them in the right direction, facilitators sometimes step out of their neutral role to share information that will move the group to a higher quality decision. In these rare cases, it's important for the facilitator to clearly indicate that he or she is stepping out of the role and explain that he or she is now playing a content role. The facilitator might say, "I need to step out of the role of facilitator for a minute and tell you that the office location you're considering is not close to any of the rapid transit corridors planned for the next 20 years. Since leaping in and out of the facilitator role causes confusion and distrust, taking off the neutral hat should be done very selectively. This role shift is justified when the facilitator is convinced that the group is in danger of making a major mistake and he or she has information or advice that will save the day. There's also a huge difference between a neutral external party asking a question or making a suggestion and a leader who's facilitating doing these things. When an outsider asks questions or offers a suggestion, members feel helped in their decision-making process. When their leader does the same thing, members likely hear an order. Learn to say, okay. When a group member says something that seems like an excellent point, facilitators can be tempted to congratulate that person by saying, good point or great idea. Unfortunately, this is a surefire way to lose your neutrality since it makes it appear that you're straying into the content and trying to influence the group's opinion. To avoid this common pitfall, substitute the word okay for good point. Okay allows you to acknowledge that you heard the point, but does not indicate any approval on your part. Whenever you're tempted to say, "I like that idea," substitute, "Do the rest of you like that idea?" After all, you're not there to judge members' suggestions, but to help them do that. When to say we. Another of the dilemmas related to neutrality concerns whether or not to say we and include oneself in the conversation. Here is the simple rule. Include yourself and say we when referring to the process. How are we doing on time? Does this approach we are taking seem to be working? Do we need a break? Use you when referring to the content. Let me read back what you've said so far. Here are the issues in the order you ranked them. Are you satisfied that this has been discussed enough? How assertive can a facilitator be? There is a common misconception that taking a neutral stance on the content of meetings means being passive. This is far from the case. In fact, if you operate on the belief that your role is basically unassertive, you'll be in danger of ending up as nothing more than a note taker or scribe.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.